Hey crew, I've got the key to this 21 Porsche 911 Turbo S lightweight. We are going to take it for a drive, but first let's check it out. It looks on the inside and outside. Now all these 992 generation 911s have more squared off lower fascias. The Turbo S has plenty of functional ventilation for the heat exchangers and intercooler, active aerodynamic flaps at the corners, LED fog lights, LED matrix headlights as standard. This one's painted in Gentian blue with a faint metallic flake. I like this color a lot, but, and this is weird to hear myself say out loud, I think I'd get this car in silver. Porsche silver is just so good. In profile, you've got a set of lightweight alloy wheels with center locking hubs, 20 inches front, 21s in the rear, wrapped in Pirelli P0 tires, 255 section front, 315s in the rear, wider rear tires than the predecessor, and bigger brakes. Up front, we've got 10 piston calipers painted in yellow versus 6 piston of the predecessor, and they're clamping on Porsche ceramic composite brakes as standard. You've got your flush mounted door handles, large inlet just in front of the rear wheels, and air pocket just behind them. Stepping back to look at the profile, it's a silhouette any enthusiast could draw with their eyes closed. But sitting on those striking wheels with the widened rear end of the Turbo S, it means business. And getting to the back, we've got a larger, lighter rear wing for 15% more downforce than the predecessor. Porsche spelled out in black here, Turbo S in body color matching, LED taillight bar going across the rear, large oval exhaust ports within a black diffuser, and that rear end, the tapered greenhouse and the prominent hips just does something to you. Okay, so someone with no attention to detail might confuse it for a standard 911, but everyone else is going to know there's something special with this car. Let's see about that interior. Opening up and looking inside at this all black interior with carbon fiber buckets as part of the lightweight package. Suede inserts for those, leather borders, Porsche crests on the headrests, optional silver seat belts. They're power raising, but manual sliding. And with the lightweight pack, we delete the rear seats. So in theory, tons of cargo space, but this is basically your only avenue to get back there. So it's not exactly convenient. On the door panels, we've got leather with contrast stitching, matte carbon fiber trim, power folding door mirrors, Bose sound system. Pull this tab to access the front trunk. It's very large, I could fit in there comfortably. And pull this tab to access the engine cover, which they don't let you do much. You can basically add wiper fluid. Sliding inside, you gotta be careful because of the high borders to the seats. You just, yeah, you flop in. A German engineered thud. Leather wrapped steering wheel. Ideal size, shape, thickness. Paddles on the back of the wheel are not huge, but they're so pleasant to actuate. Tachometer, of course, right there in the center. White background to match the white background on the Sport Chrono lap timer. Two digital gauge clusters bordering that. They are reconfigurable. Drive mode selector here on the steering wheel. 10-inch touchscreen infotainment. Quick to respond, easy to navigate, has wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. More of that matte carbon fiber trim. Knurled finishes on these toggles for the front end lift, exhaust, traction control, and adaptive dampers. Some gloss black, don't love to see it. At least it's only here though. More matte carbon fiber trim. One cup holder in the center that's removable, and one on the passenger side. Shallow compartment in the center with two USB ports. Visibility is excellent. It's good because there's not standard blind spot monitoring. Suede wrapped roof and it's domed. There's plenty of headroom, perfect for strapping on a helmet and hitting the track. There's still quite a few luxuries in here despite what the lightweight package deletes. I'm ready to take it for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. course, with our ignition on the left-hand side. That's the Porsche way. We'll select the drive mode first with this dial. And normal is how we'll be heading out. Press forward on the facial trimmer. I said that because I just want to click it off and do a bit of grooming before I head into work. It looks like it, doesn't it? It's just a knurled finish. Press forward, and that brings up the backup camera system. We've got the parking sensors as standard and just a single wide angle view. Not ultra wide, but wide angle with trajectory lines. You can get more angles if you equip the surround view camera system available on the vehicle. Back to drive. And it won't be necessary in this parking lot, but I will mention and show the front end lift feature. That's a $2,700 option. And this works very well. It's quick to raise up the nose and it auto lowers at like 35 miles per hour. What I like best is that you can do it at speed. So like if you're coming up to a driveway kind of quickly, as soon as you drop below, what is it, 25 miles per hour, you can raise the nose up so you're not having to stop traffic while you lift up the front and enter the driveway. Some of these I've experienced, like you have to be going so slow for them to actually work. We'll do our turning radius test a bit later, but for now we can start with a horn test. Way louder than I was expecting. Okay. Horn works. Powertrain in the Turbo S. This is the most potent 911 currently on sale. It is a 3.8 liter, well, 3.745 liter, if we want to get specific, twin-turbocharged flat six that makes 640 horsepower and 590 pound-feet of torque. Those are increases of 60 horsepower and 37 pound-feet over the last Turbo S. More importantly than just the extra performance is the fact that that peak torque is available consistently. It's no longer just an overboost feature, it is consistent torque availability. Now, since we're coming up to this red light, I want to test the brakes here from 64, 63. Oh my goodness. Those are some stoppers, folks. I love the tuning of the pedal. Like, yeah, there's that onset bite, but then clamps and the pedal stays firm. And we scrub speed so effortlessly. 10 pistons, that'll do it. And the ceramic coated rotors. Those brakes are good. Now with the lightweight package, we get the 10 millimeter lowered Porsche active suspension management adaptive dampers. And here with the chassis and normal, ride quality is excellent. It stays firm and taut, like you can tell this is a sports car. But it resolves the worst of road blemishes. How's the turning radius? Give it a good crank. Ah, yeah. Extremely tight. Thanks in part to the rear wheel steering system. Rear wheels will turn in the opposite direction of the front at low speeds. You just have a just pivot. Yeah, the suspension really is good. These seats being solid carbon buckets do stiffen a little of what's transferred into the cabin to your body. Compared to these standard seats, but you're not gonna be punished here. the throttle is so nice to modulate in normal mode. All the power you need, not really any defined turbo lag, even just gently working your way in. But I'm bored already, so let's see how quick the Turbo S gets to 60. To activate launch control in the Turbo S, it's simple. We just go into Sport Plus, and thankfully, Sport and Sport Plus kill the start-stop system because that's kind of annoying. And then from here, just hold your foot hard on the brake, pin the throttle. It'll hang revs around 4,000 to 5,000 RPM, and then you just let go of your foot and the brake, and you just... Well, we're going to find out. That is the quickest launch I've ever done in a car, right there. 2.7 seconds, with a slight uphill, and not perfect warmed tires, just, my goodness. There's another red light, I want to do it again. 2.7 seconds, my friends. I mean, in a world of EVs, you feel like, okay, gas-powered cars, just give it up. You can't hang anymore. But that holds on to hope for the internal combustion engine. Well, let's do it again. Oh, darn, it was slower by 0.08 of a second. 2.79 that time with some tire spin on the onset. That's absurd. I don't have words for the way that feels. I'll try, and what I'll say is that my head pressed so hard against the headrest that I'm pretty sure I left an indent on my cranium, not on the headrest. These seats absolutely hold you in place for launch. Let's see about how we do in a corner. Just the grip coming out of the corner is incredible. And the steering feel is so sweet. I feel linked, permanently linked with all the tires, so I know what's happening at all times as I pivot this wheel. I'm just floored that, well, okay, I'll continue this more in a second. We're doing a manual mode. The shifts from the PDK are just so obscenely quick. Faster than I can even think. It's time to shift gears. It's just done. And then the hit of acceleration. Very, very, very few cars have I ever driven that have this kind of mid-range pull. I'm coughing because I can't talk fast enough for how this car performs. It's just another level. Just another level of straight line speed. And enhancing that is the fact that the lightweight package has reduced insulation from the glass, so you can hear that sports exhaust system, another addition for lightweight, all the better. and above like 5,000 RPM, that flat six sings. What a car. Now, to round out what is different with the lightweight package, you are saving 60 pounds compared to the standard Turbo S, but on a vehicle that weighs over 3,600 pounds, 60 pounds isn't a huge difference. You also have different tuning for this steering rack, and that I am more curious about as we handle one more good corner. Before that, I'm also going to press and hold this button briefly to put us into Porsche Suspension Sport. Porsche Stability Sport. Sport Stability. More play. With that done, let's go see what we can do. Hard hits brakes. Delicate like a string. I honestly feel like I could have a piece of string attached to the steering wheel and control it like this, like a puppet. The fine tuning of this chassis and the way that that gives the driver full control over how the vehicle behaves is unlike 99% of cars available on the road. The rear wheel steering system now pivoting the rear wheels in the same direction as the front at higher speeds, effectively lengthening the wheelbase to give us that stability. The balance engineered into the 911 over generations of this car. The fine tuning of the throttle input, it all works together magnificently and completely disguises the 3,600 pounds of curb weight. That right there, the handling is the other bookend to the 911 Turbo S. The straight line speed is phenomenal, but the handling is just as good. So let's take it back into normal mode, and don't worry, we're not fully dead and out of the ability to go quickly, because at any point in time, I can just hit the sport response button and have all 640 horsepower and 590 pound-feet readily available. And then hit it again, and it goes away. Cruising now on the highway, though the insulation is less in this Turbo S lightweight, it's still superbly quiet. I said that as I enter the one bit of road that's loud, doesn't matter what car you're driving. There we go. Still very quiet, so easy to drive. You do have cruise control with a lane departure warning system. No more sophisticated driving aids on this car right here. Let's talk about pricing and competition for the 21 Turbo S. This vehicle starts at $204,840, and I did mention two other specs worth noting. The top speed is a whopping 205 miles per hour, and the fuel economy, 15 city, 20 highway, and 17 combined. That price tag puts the 911 Turbo S right in the middle of the two vehicles I was thinking of as rivals. The Audi R8 V10 Performance Coupe is $202,995. It makes 602 horsepower, less power than this. It's 0 to 60 is slower at 3.1 seconds. The top speed is lower at 202 miles per hour. Fuel economy is the same at 17 combined. There's also a car I drove very recently, the Maserati MC20. That one's a little more expensive, $215,995. It makes a little less power, 621 horsepower. It gets to 60 a bit slower at 2.9 seconds. Fuel economy from its six-cylinder is tied at 17 combined. Where does the Turbo S fit in, particularly with this lightweight package? So the lightweight package adds $10,340 to the Turbo S's 205-ish starting figure. I would say that what they're trying to do here, clearly, is take the Turbo S and GT2-ify it, because we don't currently have a 982 generation GT2, so they're like giving you the training wheels. They're teasing it out, but you're not fully getting that car. So I would say let's stick with the standard Turbo S, save the money, get more of the all-rounder, give up a little bit of the handling, a little bit of that sound, but in my opinion, gain more of a generalist awesome car. The MC20 is, to me, inarguably better looking. Doesn't sound as good, certainly isn't as quick or fast. I think it rides even better than this car. That's one I would really consider if you had a strong daily drive, if you've got an S-Class that you're daily driving and you just want a weekend warrior. That MC20 is a phenomenal car and really great for that purpose-built function of just getting all this attention and then being properly fun to drive. The R8 V10 sounds incredible and looks special, but it would just be spanked by the Turbo S in a straight line or in a corner. And it's, I mean, again, compared to the standard Turbo S with the rear seats and easy access, it's not as great of a daily driver. I would say that the Turbo S, if I didn't have my daily driver, would be my all-around pick. If I did, I'd go get the MC20. Regardless, if I'm choosing the Turbo S, I'm probably leaving off the lightweight package and just embracing its complete sophistication and yet obscene performance. I hope you guys have enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified, and I'll see you next time.